Angie Hickman and Spoken Realms present Malevolent Magic by Mildred Abbott. Narrated by Angie Hickman. 1. The scroogiest of Ebenezer Scrooges wouldn't have a ghost of a chance remaining immune to the holiday spirit once they entered the toy store. With Christmas a little over 2.5 weeks away, I began counting the days for it all to be over. Though I most definitely would not consider myself a Scrooge, in my defense, Halloween had barely sighed its dying breath before Estes Park began stringing lights and hanging tinsel. Those aspects only increased the charm of the Colorado mountain town, making it a beautiful Christmas village. But there are limited versions of Christmas carols a person can bear on endless loops after so many weeks. Still, surrounded by the massive assortment of old-fashioned Christmas toys carved from wood or made of hand-painted metal that filled Bushy Evergreen's workshop, the high-pitched voices of Alvin and the Chipmunks singing the Christmas song nearly got me back into the mood. I was practically in the middle of Santa's toy factory, for crying out loud. The 6-year-old girl who lived inside me couldn't help but be swept away by the wonderment and magic of it all. A whimper at my feet drew my attention away from a carved elk, with the nose painted bright red to resemble his more famous reindeer cousin. Watson grimaced up at me through slitted eyes as if he was in pain. It seemed he held no enjoyment of Alvin and the Chipmunks. If he could, I had no doubt Watson would have curled his fox-like corgi ears to block out the noise. I smiled at him and shook my head. "You are the definition of a drama queen." He only continued to scowl. Maybe I was wrong. Watson was probably the scroogiest of Ebenezer Scrooges, and he wasn't a convert. We rounded the corner, past a pyramid of stuffed animals, and came into view of the counter, which was outlined in twinkling multicolored lights. Old Duncan Diamond, the carver of the wooden toys, and his son Dolan were huddled together in front of a computer screen. Both seemed heavy in concentration. So much so that at Watson's and my movement, Dolan glanced at us, then instantly returned to the computer before flinching and looking back up once more, clearly startled. He darted his gaze from me to Watson, then toward the front door and back.
"Goodness, you two snuck in."
Duncan gave a little flinch of his own at Dolan's voice, but smiled instantly when he saw us.
"Didn't even hear the door chime."
There was a flicker of sadness in his eyes, and I knew he was thinking of the year before, the loss and betrayal that had happened where Watson and I stood. But the look was gone in an instant, and his smile returned.
"To what do we owe the pleasure of a visit from Winifred Page and her corgi sidekick? I know your nephews and nieces are much too old for any of the toys I offer here at this point."
"Nice to see you both." I didn't try to argue and finished my path to the counter, letting a little slack loose in Watson's leash so he could wander around if he wanted. "And there are two things, actually." I dug into my purse and pulled out a notepad. "Katie and I had an idea, and I'm making a quick jaunt around town to see if other store owners are interested."
Dolan gave an exaggerated shiver. "It's the coldest day we've had in weeks. If you're walking all over downtown in this weather, you're tougher than me."
He shrugged good-naturedly.
"Although we already knew that."
Before I could respond, Duncan patted his son on the back.
"But you're sweet, kind, and pure of heart."
He refocused on me.
"So, what's this scheme you and the baker sent from the gods have come up with?"
The first time I met him, Duncan Diamond seemed so old and sad. Now, despite heavy wrinkles on his face, he was lighter, happier. That helped me remember the point of Christmas spirit even more than the beauty of the toy shop. "We thought we'd use the final rush of tourists for some good. We're putting together a coupon book for all the shops. The booklet will cost $25, and we'll have discounts for all participating stores inside. All the profits will be split between the toy drive at the hospital, the women's shelter, and the animal rescue." Though Bushy Evergreen's workshop was at least the 10th store I'd visited the past couple of hours, I felt heat rise to my cheeks. I hated asking for things, even when they weren't for me.
"There's no pressure at all, but anything you'd be willing—"
"What do you think, Dad?"
Dolan didn't even hesitate as he looked at Duncan.
15% off all purchases and a free— We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.